Okay, start. Any questions or comments from the last lecture? Okay, well, today I want to talk about what I think is, in some sense, really the heart of the issues concerning Majorana fermions, or at least the it's why they're interesting. So, basically, the reason for the huge surge of interest in Majorana fermions over the last few years has been the prospect that they may be usable for a form of quantum computing which is at least partially topologically protected. We'll come back later to why only partially, but at least it'll be a big leap forward if this is possible. Let me start off by reminding you of some fairly, by now, elementary considerations concerning Berry phases, because we are going to want to talk about these in some detail later. Let's suppose that we have some wave function. It could be a single particle wave function, it could be a many-body one, it doesn't matter. And suppose it's a function of some control parameter, lambda, and lambda is swept adiabatically around some kind of closed circuit and returned to its original value. Then, of course, in general, the wave function will pick up some kind of dynamical phase, exponential minus iet, etc., but we forget about that and rather concentrate on the fact that the so-called Berry phase, which is by definition the essentially the phase picked up because we have been around a non-trivial closed circuit, is given by this expression here, psi star lambda d psi by d lambda d lambda, which is, because of the normalization of psi, this actually turns out to be just identically equivalent to this expression here. So this in general, what we find is that this expression will in general be non-zero, and that's the definition of the so-called Berry phase. For the moment we're dealing with the simplest case, and this Berry phase is automatically abelian. We're only dealing with one parameter lambda here. A very standard example of the Berry phase is to consider a particle spin a half in a magnetic field which is tilted with respect to the z-axis and rotated around it like so. And you imagine that this is done sufficiently slowly that the spin state of the particle will always adiabatically follow the magnetic field. Now, we discuss this problem. We need to choose an appropriate form of the spinner wave function, which just in general write as alpha and beta. Alpha and beta are going to be some functions of the direction of the magnetic field along which the spin will lie. And really, there's only one, strictly speaking, one criterion for a correct choice of alpha and beta. Namely, it should get correctly the result that the x component of the spin with the normal conventions is the cosine of, the z component of spin with the normal choice of convention for the axes should be cos theta. The x component should be sine theta cos phi, and the y component sine theta sine phi. So the criterion for choosing alpha and beta is that it gets these correct. Now, one standard choice is, which you often find written in the standard quantum mechanics textbooks, is that alpha is chosen because theta over 2 e to the I phi over 2, and beta is sine theta over 2 times e to the minus phi over 2. That does, in fact, get those those expectation values right. However, it's not single valued. You see that if I go once around a loop in phi, this does not return to its original value. So I prefer not to have that. And so if we multiply that by any overall factor, if we just take the total spin and wave function and multiply it by some phase factor, which is a function of phi, that will leave the expectation values unchanged. So it's convenient to require alpha and beta to be single-valued functions of phi. And so one possible choice would be that alpha is, you just multiply by e to the I, e to the minus I phi over 2, and what you then find is that alpha is cos theta over 2, beta is this, with the e to the minus I phi in it. And you notice that over all of the, over almost all of the unit sphere, these are single-valued. The only point at which this one is not single-valued is the on the negative z-axis, where this is obviously not defined. But apart from that, they are single-valued. And now you can actually evaluate your Berry phase. The Berry phase is now your control parameter essentially is the angle phi made by the magnetic field. So so we evaluate integral psi d psi by d phi. That has two bits, one coming from the alpha component, one coming from the beta component. You just work those out, put them together, and you get the integral of sine squared theta over 2. Well, theta is constant, so you can do that. And that comes out to be pi over cos theta minus 1. That's actually negative. If I want to be positive, I just have to take my circuit in the opposite direction. So that's no difficulty. So apart from the sine, it turns out that this is the Berry phase just the area on the unit sphere swept out by the magnetic field. Very standard textbook stuff. Just a few notes. It's interesting that when theta equals pi over 2, that will, just going back for a moment, that gives you, then in that case, cos theta is 0, so that gives you, apart from a minus sign, that gives you pi. And that simply tells you that if my magnetic field is in the xy plane, and I just sweep it around once, I'm going to recover my original wave function, but with a minus sign. That's the famous 4-pi symmetry of spinners, which has actually been verified experimentally, Newton interferometry. Had we taken a different so-called monodromic choice, which this is another choice possible, which makes the spinner wave function single-valued, this time except at the North Pole. And then what you've got is that the Berry phase is now pi into 1 plus cos theta, but that is just the original value we got last time, plus 2 pi. And obviously a phase difference of 2 pi is unimportant. Now, it is possible, this is a technicality I don't really want to go into unless anyone's specially interested, but you could take an arbitrary zeta of phi, which would, not make these single-valued, and then you've got an extra term here, and you'd have to deal with that. As I say, that's a technicality. We don't need to do that, so I won't worry about that. Any questions, comments on that? I hope that's sort of fairly well-known textbook stuff to most of you. Okay. Now, here's another example, which is going to, in fact, is going to be a lot more interesting for our purposes, and there is a reason why I put this in. Let's imagine a single Schrödinger particle moving in a potential, V of R, which is cylindrically symmetric, except for a hole, which is at a distance R0 from the origin. And imagine now that we move this hole adiabatically so as to encircle the origin. And the question is, what Berry phase, if any, is picked up in this operation? Now, here's the crucial point. The wave function is a function of R, of the radial coordinate R, which is not particularly interesting to us. It's a function of theta and of the position theta 0 of the hole that you're moving around. However, by symmetry, it has to be a function only of theta minus theta zero. And therefore, when we take the Berry phase, it's defined by this expression here, but we can replace that by minus I d psi theta zero by d theta zero. Something gone wrong here, actually. I'm sorry, this is my fault. This should be psi of theta d by d theta zero psi of theta. That's the definition of the Berry phase. This should be psi of theta minus I d psi of theta by d theta here, d theta zero. But this expression is nothing other than the angular momentum. And therefore, the value of the Berry phase is simply the expectation value of the angular momentum. And so, for example, if the particle is not in an eigenstate of the angular momentum, for example, suppose that the particle you're talking about, suppose this is some kind of attractive central potential here. We didn't have to say it was central, but let's imagine that it is for a moment. So this is an attractive central potential, and relative to that, the particle could be in an S state, or it could be in a P state, or it could be in some combination of the two, right? If it's in some combination of the two, then in general, it's not in an eigenstate of angular momentum with respect to the center here, and therefore you'll get a Berry phase which is non-trivial, 2 pi times b squared here, okay? What's quite surprising is that this result is independent both of the strength of the potential and of the distance R0 that you often need. Okay? So this, I think, is quite interesting, and in a moment we'll see that it's actually can be generalized. Yes?
Like
a
hole, you mean like an
antiparticle? Sorry?
I'm sorry,
I shouldn't have used the word hole. I should have used the word potential well. Potential. So it's just some kind of potential. Well, let's imagine this is an attractive potential and it can actually bind certain kinds of bound state. It can bind an S state and a P state, etc. Okay? Then you get this interesting result that the Berry phase for this simple case comes out to be simply the expectation value of the angular momentum. Now, this can actually be generalised, and this was actually due to my, who I guess is not here right now, but is here at IQC. And I should say, incidentally, that a lot of the stuff which is not textbook stuff, which I'll be talking about for the rest of these lectures, was done in collaboration with Euro. And he actually noticed the following very interesting generalisation. Suppose that the many-body wave function, when expressed in terms of the particle coordinates theta, the angular coordinates, is a function only of theta minus theta zero. We'll come to some situations where that's true. Then the Berry phase is, again, by definition, given by this expression here. But now, again, from the form of this function here, d by d theta zero is minus sum over j d by d theta j, phi b, is given by this expression here. Again, it's the expectation value of the orbital angular momentum. So that's something we're going to use later to a considerable extent. Very briefly, we can begin to see why our fermions are non-abelian anions. Before discussing this in detail, let me just notice one simple result. Let's imagine that we have a single DB always stands in these lectures for Dirac-Bogoliubov. A Dirac-Bogoliubov quasi-particle that is not a Majorana on a fermion. Let's consider a single Dirac-Bogoliubov quasi-particle which is carried around an Abrikosov vortex. And let's just apply the standard mean field approach, in which the quasi-particle is a mix of a particle with spin up and a hole with spin down. More generally, of a particle and a hole. Now, Formally, that problem is exactly analogous to a spin a half particle in a tilted magnetic field. And the analogue of taking the magnetic field around a loop, like so, is simply varying the phase of your gap through 2 pi. And so we reproduce the same result, that when the argument of delta R is reversed, then in fact you get this change here. If that that applies equally to Majorana fermions, and therefore, at least at first sight, when you change the phase of the superconducting gap by 2 pi, then you change the phase of the Majorana fermion by pi. Now that's a delicate point, and we're going to have to come back to that, but notice that. Okay, now we come to the real nitty-gritty. This is, much of the rest of this lecture is going to be based on a rather well-known paper by Ivanov in Physical Review Letters in 2001, which was the first, apart from some work by Nyack and Wilczek, which actually had to do explicitly with the quantum Hall effect and therefore has to be transposed to this problem. But Ivanov, I think, was the first person to consider explicitly the statistics of Majorana fermions in P plus IP superfluids. Now, his argument is not entirely clear at all times, so I'm going to present it, but I'm not going to stake my life that it's right, and we'll come back to that point later. So let's imagine that we have a P plus IP superfluid, like possibly helium-3, like possibly strontium ruthenate, and let's imagine that we have an even number of vortices. Okay, we don't have to, and we could deal with the odd case, but let's for simplicity assume we have an even number, and for the moment let's even make the slightly unrealistic assumption that they are actually all vortices rather than vortices and anti-vortices. That's simply for simplicity. And let's consider the result of exchanging the vortices I and I plus 1. So we just numbered them in an arbitrary way and consider this exchange. Now, the way that Ivanov argues, which I think is not entirely clear-cut, is in the following way. You imagine that you want the... what you have is a phase which rotates through 2 pi as you go through around either of these vortices. Imagine that you cope with that. This is the unclear bit about Ivanov's argument. You know, I'm eventually have to go back to this. Let's imagine that you make the phase single valued by putting in a 2 pi pi jump in it. And then imagine that you exchange these two vortices. Well, that's equivalent to this operation here. And what Ivanov argues now, so this is the bit which really I think is not entirely clear cut. He argues that the vortex I, that's probably this one here, that sees no change in the phase of the superconducting order parameter from a delta. The vortex I plus 1 sees a change of 2 pi. So not entirely clear cut. Let's imagine that we go with that. Then gamma I is transformed into gamma I plus 1. Gamma I plus 1 is now you remember that when vortex I plus 1 sees a change of 2 pi in the gap, that means that the gammas undergo a change of pi. So so now he's got these transformations here. These are the important ones. For all the rest, which are not involved in this interchange, the gamma i's are totally unchanged. So this is, in some sense, this is the basic result of which Ivanov claims comes from interchanging these two vortices. And this, everything is going to rely on this. So, as I say, it's not entirely transparent, but that's what he does. Notice, incidentally, that this, it turns out, you can actually work this out explicitly, that this operation does, the operation defined in this way, means that the TIs for the different I's from 1 to n satisfy the so-called braid group commutation relations. And that turns out to be characteristic of so-called anionic statistics.
What statistics again?
Sorry?
What's that? Typical, what, your last phrase, what statistics?
Anionic. I think I said Ising. Ising anionic statistics. Ising anions are a particular kind of anions. They seem to occur in a number of different places. According to the usual wisdom, they occur in people's IP superfluids. So now, I think that's the difficult bit, as it were. The rest is perhaps not that immediately transparent, but with a bit of algebra, it does come out. So the question is, what operator is going to affect this effect, is going to effect this transformation? And the answer is that the operator in question can be written in this form, 1 plus gamma I plus 1, gamma I. Now, there's an interesting algebraic identity here. Because of the commutation, the appropriate commutation relations of the gammas, the square of gamma I plus 1 gamma I is minus 1, and that means, this is perhaps not immediately obvious, you just stare at it, but it comes out with a bit of algebra, that means that this expression here can equally well be written in this form here, and it's sometimes convenient to write it in this form here. Notice there's no I in that expression. Okay, it's exponential pi over 4. Okay. How did that come out? Well, you just have to, the easiest way to see this is just to write this out as a series expansion, a power law here, and use this fact here, and then you'll find it can in fact be expressed in this form here. This is basically cos pi over 4 here. Okay, so that's the generator, as it were, of this this transformation. Now let's start off by considering two vortices. Then the Hilbert space is two-dimensional. The two dimensions correspond, first of all, to no fermions present, and then to a single Dirac fermion present. And remember, the interesting point now is that this single Dirac fermion, or I should call it really a Dirac Bogoliubov fermion, I guess, the Dirac Bogoliubov fermion is delocalized between these two vortices, however far apart they are. We can express the creation operators, the creation operator for this Bogoliubov Dirac fermion, in terms of the Majoranas, as we did in the last lecture. And remembering that the Majoranas anti-commute, then the number operator, that is, which just counts whether the number of fermions is 1 or 0, is given by this expression here, which means that this, I gamma 1, gamma 2, is simply sigma z. So that means that this operator here can be written as e to the I pi over 4 times sigma z. Now, it's often, this is one of these tricks where you have to be rather careful, actually. But if we assume that it's okay just to multiply our wave functions, and therefore our operators, by an arbitrary overall phase factor, then we can just multiply it by this quantity for convenience. And lo and behold, what this comes out as is this matrix here. In other words, first of all, what does this say? This says that when we interchange the two vortices, first of all, we don't change the number of fermions that are sitting on them, which is sort of obvious in some sense. You wouldn't expect it to. However, moreover, with this convention, the effect of interchanging the two vortices when there's nothing on them, no myrons around, is trivial. It just gives us the identity. And I mean, in some sense, this seems sensible because, after all, what are your vortices? In some sense, they're classical-like objects. They're just simply characterized by their position. So it'd be rather weird if interchanging them were to do anything special for that simple case. However, here's the interesting bit. When you have two Majoranas sitting on these vortices, in other words, one Dirac-Bogoliubov fermion, then you multiply by I. In other words, exchanging the two vortices leaves the state unchanged, this is no fermion present, and changes the phase by pi over 2 if there is a fermion present. That's crucial. Notice that is not the case. What would be the case if you were talking about an ordinary situation involving exchange of two real electrons? If you exchange two real electrons, then you get a phase of pi, not pi over 2. So that's really crucial. Let me just stop a moment and ask if there are any questions on this, because this really is I think, the essential step in the Ivanov derivation. And we're going to have to come back eventually and see if we believe this. Okay, so let's go on to a more interesting case, which is the case of two fermions. And for the moment, you remember that the pairing, the association which we make between these different vortices, at first sight at least, looks arbitrary. So let's just associate vortex 1 and 2 and vortex 3 and 4. And at this point, it's essential to make sure you've got your ordering consistent. In other words, you've got to define your two fermion state as A dagger 1, A dagger 2 times acting on the no fermion state, not A dagger 2, A dagger 1. If you do it the wrong way around, you get a minus sign, and that plays all hell with it. So I hope I've kept my signs consistent. I've tried to keep as close to Ivanov's original work as possible here. Again, I can't stake my life that I have. Could be there's a minus sign floating around somewhere here, but I can guarantee you the final results come out all right anyway. But this is real pain when you actually have to work it out in detail. So now we have these four vortices. So we have the possibility of either two or four Majorana fermions sitting on them. Let's define vortices 1 and 2 as forming what we'll call qubit 1, and 3 and 4 as forming qubit 2. So we have two qubits now. So now the operation of exchanging 1 and 2, we've just seen, gives us this factor here, which we chose to multiply by an overall phase factor, but let's for the moment go back to its original form, which is this. Similarly, the operation of exchanging 3 and 4 gives us this by the same argument. But the interesting question is, what happens if we exchange 2 and 3? Now, what is tor of, in other words, what is tor of T2? Well, you remember that rather generally, the operation of exchanging I and I plus 1 was given by exponential pi. Let's just write it up. Is given by tor of I equals exponential pi over 4. And now, I'm probably misremembering this. I've probably got it the wrong way round, but gamma I plus 1 gamma I. So now let's rewrite this in terms of the real fermion operators. Gamma 2 is given by A dagger 2 plus A2. Gamma 3 is part of 3 is part of qubit 2. So we express that in terms of the annihilation and creation operators of qubit 2. There's a slight, I'm afraid there's a notational problem here. When applied to the gammas, the numbers simply are the numbers of the vortices. When applied to the A's, they're the numbers of the qubits, qubits 1 and 2. I hope that's not going to cause too much confusion. It's just a notational dilemma. So gamma 3 is that. Gamma 2 is I times A dagger 1, qubit 1 minus A1. So gamma 3, gamma 2 squared is minus 1. That's a more general statement. Tau of T2 is given by this. And we can re-express that in this form. We've already done that. And now writing this, let's write this out explicitly. And here, well, first of all, notice that the suffixes are referring to the two qubits, not to the four vortices here. And secondly, it is extremely important to make sure you've taken things in the right order. You can get into an enormous mess if you get this wrong. And so, if we now write out this expression in terms explicitly of the four states, we find a matrix like this here, and in this what are the four states now? Are no Dirac Bogoliubov fermions at all, a Dirac Bogoliubov fermion on qubit number 1, that is on vortices 1 and 2, and nothing on 3 and 4. Again, a state with a qubit on, a Dirac Bogoliubov fermion on 3 and 4, nothing on 1 and 2, and finally, a state with Dirac Bogoliubov fermions on both of these, in other words, 4 Majorana fermions. So in that basis, this is what the transformation T2 looks like. Now, I've written this out so that as it were, the degree of freedom within this this corner here or this corner here within these blocks refers to qubit number 1, and the partition between here and here refers to qubit number 2. So you have to think about that a little to see that comes out. And now what's remarkable is that if you write this out now in terms of the Pauli matrices involved, then this is 1 minus I times sigma x acting on qubit 1 times sigma x acting on qubit 2. And that obviously is an entangling operation. So this then assures us that we can by braiding vortices 2 and 3, we can actually entangle our two qubits, 1 and 2, here. However, that's actually a bit misleading, because, in fact, all the operations we're considering do preserve the number parity of the state. And in fact, all real-life physical operations also preserve the number parity. And therefore, it's preferable to fix the parity and regard the four-anion system, the four vortex system, as a single qubit associated with anions 1 and 2. For example, for odd in, we regard the zero state as one with no Majorana fermion on 1 and 2, and two Majorana fermions on 3 and 4. And that, in the matrix I showed just there, that actually corresponds to the third row. Again, you better get that right. If you don't watch that, you get minus signs floating all around and life becomes hell. So your two states in the odd end sector are ones in which there is a Majorana fermion on 1 and 2, no Majorana fermions on 1 and 2, and 1 on 3 and 4. The one state is one in which there is a Majorana fermion on 1 and 2, and nothing on 3 and 4. And that corresponds to the second row and column. for even in some sense it's a little bit easier to see what's going on, for even in, the zeroth state is one in which there are no Majorana fermions at all, and that corresponds to the first row and column of the matrix. The one is one in which there are Majorana fermions on all four of your vortices, and that this is a typo here, I'm afraid. This should be the fourth row and column of the matrix, not the second. Yeah. So with the this convention, we have for odd n that the zero state is given by this. This is just rewriting what I said here, basically. And for odd n, we get this. For even n, we get this. And therefore, we just rearrange now. We just rearrange the matrix that we wrote down previously. Just shuffle the rows and columns appropriately. And we find that tor of T2 is given by this in the new form is given by this expression here. And now you see we've completely decoupled, as we'd expect to do, we've decoupled the even and odd sectors. And it turns out that in both the even and the odd subspaces, I gamma 3 gamma 2 just comes out to be minus I sigma x. Well, here it is, you see. It's the same in both sectors, and it's equal to minus I sigma x. Now, in this representation, we find that our braiding matrices, again, multiplying by an arbitrary overall abelian phase factor, again, we're going to have to come back to this because it's not entirely obvious this is kosher always, but let's do it for the moment. We find that we write R12 in this form, R34, again, have to be careful about getting the order right, otherwise this gets screwed up. And R23 is the interesting one, which now corresponds to this matrix here, which involves sigma x. So these clearly involve sigma z, this involves sigma x. Again, if we just go back to multiplying by this phase factor, we can write them in this form. So this is exponential I pi over 4 times, now there is an I in here, exponential I pi over 4 times sigma x, and R23 is given by this expression here involving sigma x. Well, it's fairly obvious that when defined in this way, the R's trivially satisfy the braid group, the first braid group relation. Question, do they satisfy the second one? And for that you have to just do a bit of algebra. And it turns out that when you calculate R12 times R23 times R12, that gives you 1 over root 2 times sigma x plus sigma z. Now, you see that since sigma x and sigma z occur symmetrically in this expression, then it must also be true that R23 gives you this same expression here. So, because they are indifferent by exchanging x and z. So yes, you do, first of all, you do satisfy the braid group relations. And secondly, what this now means is that you can perform all possible pi over 4 rotations within this space. Okay, you can rotate by pi over 4 around the z-axis. You can rotate by pi over 4 around the x-axis. And if you want to do it around the y-axis, all you've got to do is, I think, to do it twice around the z-axis and then once around the x-axis, and that'll have the same effect. Anyway, the ways of doing this. But the question is that going to give you all possible rotations in your two-dimensional space? Because remember, ideally what we'd like to do is to construct a system which would perform universal quantum computation and have it topologically protected. So it's well known that in order to achieve universal quantum computation, what's necessary is to be able to perform all possible rotations of a single qubit, plus at least one entangling two-qubit operation. Well, we've got our two-qubit entangling operation. We saw that we did have one. Do we have all possible all possible single-qubit rotations? Answer: no, because this is not enough to do that. The technical word is that the word is that the group is not dense in O3. Incidentally, does anyone happen to know or remember what this group of all possible pi over 4 rotations is called? I mean, other than just the group of all possible pi over 4 rotations. Okay, well, anyway, I think it does have a name. Okay, so far so good. We've got ourselves starting with 4 vortices and 4 Majorana fermions. What we've managed to do is to generate 2 possible ways of producing a single effective qubit, one of them in the even parity sector and one in the odd parity sector. We've still only got, in each of these, we've only still got a single qubit. Suppose now we want to be a little more ambitious and generate 2 qubits. How are we going to do that? Well, the simplest way of generating 2 qubits is to use 6 anions, that is 6 vortices. We'll associate qubit number 1 with the states of the anion pair 1 and 2, and qubit number 2 with the pair 5 and 6. And for definite parity, for example, odd parity, then the resultant Hilbert space is 2 to the n minus 1 dimensional, and that corresponds to 2 qubits, as it should. We're going to use the pair 3 and 4 to, in some sense, soak up any parity deficiency. So, for example, we can take the 4 states to B for odd n. The zero state of both qubits will be 0, 1, 0, where 1 means that the qubit 3, the pseudo qubit, as it were, composed of 3 and 4, is going to be in state 1. 1 sub 1, 0 sub 2 is going to be this, then this, and finally we're going to get this. These will form then our 4 possible states within the odd parity sector. And we can do the same for the even parity sector. Now, again, let's ask, what are the effects of the various braids? Well, as before, if we're braiding neighbouring vortices which are part of the same qubit, then an exchange, a braid, will give us e to the I pi over 4 sigma z1. Similarly, R5, 6 will give us e to the I pi over 4 sigma z2, qubit number 2. But of course, the interesting question now is, well, again, R2, 3 is given by this expression here, R4, 5 by that. But what about the effect of R3, 4? That's the interesting one, where we take these two, as it were, pseudo, these two superfluous Majoranas and braid those. What's that going to do for us? Well, acting on the pseudo qubit 3, 4, that's guaranteed to give us this expression. So when expressed in terms of our basis states, that means that R3, 4 gives us that. R3, 4 of that gives us this, but R3, 4 acting on this guy gives us this, and R3, 4 acting on this gives us this. And so in the two-qubit basis, now I have an awful feeling that there may be a, there's probably a typo in this one here, I suspect. Because this is actually given by that's going to be, what's that going to be? It's going to be plus e to the I, it's going to be zero whenever these, the sigma the sigmas are both 1 and 0 when they're both minus 1, so it gives us a 1 here. Sorry, I'm afraid I was in a hurry, failed to check the exact form of this matrix. But the point is, it basically gives you a controlled rotation gate. I'll fix that for the final notes. It gives you a definite entangling gate between your two qubits. So now we see that by using 6 anions, we permit a large set, but still not a complete set of 1 and 2 qubit operations. And that basically is the substance of Ivanov's paper. There's a lot of stuff if you actually read Ivanov's paper, there's a lot of stuff which I regard as somewhat superfluous about how you actually describe a half quantum vortex in a spin triplet, P plus IP, superfluid. He goes in, following Volovic, he goes into what it seemed to me totally unnecessary notational complications involving that. So that's a substantial chunk of the paper, but this is basically the interesting bit. So any questions or comments on that? Okay, so what we've seen then is that by using six vortices, we can effectively produce in either the even or odd parity sector a two-qubit setup. And we can then perform both single particle rotation, single qubit rotations, and at least one entangling operation on these two qubits. So in some sense we're in business. Now how do we actually carry out in detail, how would we actually perform in detail a topologically protected quantum computation? This is actually discussed in some considerable sort of generality by my colleague Mike Stone and his former students at Wing Chun in this paper in 2006, which is one of the important papers in this whole this area. And they do this in the language of, in the formal language of the Ising anion statistics. I won't go into that, I don't think it's particularly useful for our purposes, but physically, what would you actually do to carry out a quantum computation? Well, let's consider the very simplest case, which is we would like to simply produce a single qubit and show that we can carry out the Pauli sigma x operation on it. Okay, how are we going to do this using this kind of system? Again, this is very much an in-principle discussion. I'm not going to to go into how we would actually couple to the vortices to move them around. But just notice one thing. We do not have to, in some sense, we don't have to couple to the Majoranas directly. What we have to do is to couple to the vortices and move those around. And certainly in a charged system, this should not be impossible. It should be possible to put in, some kind of little magnetic tip or whatever and move it around. So that is not in principle, at least, a problem. We imagine we can do that. So what we need is at least 4 vortices or antivortices. It's actually usually easier to create them as vortex-antivortex pairs rather than as pairs of vortices. Remember that if you try to put 2 parallel vortices together, This gives you a single vortex with angular momentum or with circulation 2, and that is not stable. So they're going to resist doing this. On the other hand, doing the other thing, putting a vortex and antivortex together, they will just cancel and give you the vacuum, essentially. So let's imagine we start with a vacuum and then create a vortex-antivortex pair, or two of them, to be precise. Now, let's just for a moment digress and ask, what happens when a vortex-antivortex pair merges? Well, first of all, what if it's carrying, it's not doing anything interesting? Suppose this vortex-antivortex pair is carrying no Majorana fermions. Well, then when you put your vortex and antivortex together, what happens? Well, you just get the vacuum. I mean, assuming that you do it sufficiently adiabatically, etc., etc. Right? So in this case, you just get the vacuum, that is the many-body ground state. If, on the other hand, you're carrying two Majorana fermions, then what happens? Well, now you remember that pair of Majorana fermions was just equivalent to a single Dirac-Bogoliubov fermion. So, as you bring these two this vortex and antivortex together, what's going to happen? Well, eventually, the vortex and antivortex themselves are just going to merge and give you the vacuum. What are you going to do with your extra Dirac-Bogoliubov quasar particle? Well, once you've got the homogeneous vacuum, the only fermionic states are the ones above the gap. So, in other words, the genuine, honest-to-goodness Bogoliubov quasar particles, the usual ones. Okay, so crudely speaking, what's going to happen is that your single Dirac-Bogoliubov fermion becomes a good bulk fermion, right? And this is something you can measure, hopefully. Measure it, for example, by... So question, how do you tell whether you've got that extra fermion there or not? One of the things you might try to do, for example, is to put in some kind of vibrating wire in your liquid and see if it's damped by this extra fermion. That's just an in-principle possibility. But there are ways, at least, of measuring this. So this is something you should be able to measure. Incidentally, one interesting point, which I think has not really been discussed in the literature, is that you remember that since you have an overall P plus IP superfluid with a certain circulation, a certain handiness, it's either clockwise or anticlockwise. This means that a vortex and an antivortex are in some sense not equivalent. And in particular, the Majorana fermions, which are sitting on a vortex and an anti-vortex, are not going to be the same. Whereas sitting on two vortices, of course, they are going to be the same. So this means when you recombine a vortex-anti-vortex pair, the Bogoliubov quasar particle you're going to get out at the end of the day is not necessarily the same as the one you would have got by combining a vortex-vortex pair. So I don't think, certainly in this paper, I don't think that point is discussed, and I don't think it has been discussed in the literature as far as I know. But that doesn't really affect the main thrust of the argument. So let's imagine that you work in the even parity sector for definiteness. So you start off by creating two simple vortex-antivortex pairs, 1, 2, and 3, and 4. So no Majorana fermions. You then separate them by using, as I say, some kind of pair of magnetic tips or something. You separate them to large distances. Still, there are no Majorana fermions. That was the state in row 1 and column 1 of our original matrix. Now you braid, or that is exchange, vortices 2 and 3. That's the T2 operation which we examined, and at least according to Ivanov's argument, that changes state 1 into state 4. So now state 4 is one on which you have zero energy Bogoliubov quasar particles on both pairs, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Now what you have to do is to bring them back, recombine or merge the we have to recombine or merge the original pairs 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. In each case, the energy of the Bogoliubov quasar particle must be at least the minimum one, the bulk gap. So on final recombination, we get out two bulk Bogoliubov quasar particles. So in principle, we can tell that we have conducted a sigma x operation on one qubit. And again, if you wanted to, for example, show that you could carry out an entangling operation, then what you would need to do is to generate originally three vortex-antivortex pairs. That gives you two qubits. You can go through the operations which you specified and eventually recombine and read off what's happened. Incidentally, an interesting question that arises which we can perhaps go into later, suppose that you chose to recombine not the pairs which you'd originally produced, but a different set of pairs. For example, suppose you recombined 1 and 3 and 2 and 4. What would happen then? Okay. So that's something we put aside for the moment. In principle, everything that we can do should be topologically protected. Why so? Well, there's some slight questions about the original creation of your vortex antivortex pairs. Let's just put that aside for a moment and ask, as soon as you separated out and you separated your vortices to large distances, why is this operation topologically protected? Well, crudely speaking, the reason is that, as we emphasized earlier, there is simply no way of telling by any local probe whether you've got a Majorana there or not. So you can be moving your vortices around, and nature, as it will not have a way of knowing whether this particular vortex is carrying a Majorana or not. We may have sophisticated ways of being able to detect it, but certainly nothing that nature can do, that is the ordinary mechanisms which lead to decoherence, should not be able to see this. Now I come to a...
What is the impact of decoherence here, again?
Oh, well, fine. If you were doing an ordinary quantum computation which didn't involve Majorana fermions or anything similar, suppose, for example, you're just doing a straightforward quantum computation using, say, superconducting qubits. Superconducting qubits have two, by definition, they have two different states which you're trying to operate on. But in this particular case, the two states are in some sense macroscopically distinct. That is, a very large number of electrons are, crudely speaking, doing something different in the two states. For example, they could be circulating clockwise around a squid loop or anticlockwise. Now, the odds are that nature is going to know, going to have ways of finding out which of these two is happening. For example, typically the circulating currents might give rise to a magnetic field, which would then affect various bits of the environment. So, and even if you didn't read that off, nevertheless, this means that in some sense the environment knows which of these two states is realized. That immediately means that the density matrix in your 2x2 space becomes decohered, meaning that the off-diagonal elements tend to zero. And then you've lost your quantum computation. So the whole point of the idea of using Majorana fermions is that now your two states might, for example, let's go back to our four vortex setup, and let's, for example, work in the odd parity sector. Then, in the basis that you've chosen, your two states correspond. State zero corresponds to having a single direct Bogoliubov fermion on vortices 1 and 2, and nothing on 3 and 4. And your state 1 corresponds to having a vortex, direct Bogoliubov fermion on states 3 and 4, and nothing on 1 and 2. And the question is, can nature easily tell which of these two states is happening? And the answer is no, because there's no local probe which will tell you whether a particular pair of vortices is occupied by a direct Bogoliubov fermion. Okay, so now we get to the real, to the first bit of real skepticism, as it were. So far, I've basically been presenting the argument of Ivanov, which has been very widely accepted in the literature. And now let's be a little more skeptical and ask the question: is all this actually justified? Well, first of all, let's just consider the problem of a single vortex, or a vortex-antivortex pair. A single vortex pair, or a vortex-antivortex pair. Now, the first problem appears relatively trivial, and indeed may be so, but I think it's still worth raising. Ivanov's argument actually gives for the exchange of a single vortex pair, it gives you your matrix in the form of exponential I pi over 4 times sigma z, which is equivalently expressed in this form here. And that is then corrected by simply multiplying by an overall abelian phase. Incidentally, when we say it's the phrase abelian phase tends to be used rather frequently in the literature. When it's said that this is abelian, what you basically mean is that you can multiply by these phase factors in arbitrary order, and it's not going to make any difference. And so you correct it by so as to give this result here. But should you be doing that, actually? Well, after all, the overall phase you are talking. Well, now we have to be a little careful. The operation of interchanging two vortices does not, strictly speaking, give you a Berry phase as such, because you have not, or at least not obviously, come back to the same situation as you had originally. However, if you take twice, which is equivalent to fixing one vortex and moving the other one around it, then you clearly have come back to the same situation, and so a Berry phase should be well defined. Well, this encirclement operation, in which you just hold one fixed and move two around it, the 2 pi, that is equivalent, apart from an overall translation which is irrelevant, that's equivalent to simply twice, interchanging twice. So, in other words, the appropriate operator which affects that operation should look like this. In other words, when I take fixed 2 now and I'm moving 1 around it, this should be the way in which my wave function is multiplied. But that then implies that the Neumayer on a fermion state acquires a Berry phase of pi over 2 on encirclement. That seems very weird. Now, okay, at this point, I think most of the community would just wave their hands and say, okay, but you're only talking about an overall abelian phase, so it can't really matter. I'm not entirely sure about that, actually, but let's just suppose that that's right, and pretend that the only physically relevant Berry phase is the difference between that for the no Majorana and Majorana and 2 Majorana states. Well, that is well defined. That doesn't depend on your overall phase factor. That is pi over 2 for exchange, therefore pi for encirclement. Okay, so let's for the moment live with that that conclusion. The next problem, however, is this difference, that is the difference between the no Majoranas and 2 Majorana states, the difference between the Berry phases in those two, is that correct? In other words, does the state of two vortices when they are exchanged, when they're carrying a single zero energy Bogoliubov quasar particle, does that phase change by pi over 2 relative to the state without the fermion? Okay, well, before I discuss this, let me just digress for a moment to what appears to be at first sight a simpler problem. Let's consider forget all about Majoranas for a moment. Just consider a simple Bogoliubov quasar particle in a vortex. And we're going to now combine arguments, the usual arguments based on spontaneously broken U1 symmetry, and the arguments based on Berry phase. Let's consider now, nothing fancy, a simple neutral S-wave superfluid in a large annulus. So the radius is very large compared to the pair radius. Let's construct a Zeeman trap such that the potential is, which is proportional to B of theta, is is like this. It has a dimple with a minimum at, say, theta 0. And let's adjust the parameters so that there's exactly one bound state of appropriate spin in the trap. Moreover, let's assume that the width of the trap and therefore of the state in question is large compared to the pair radius. So the energy now is approximately delta. What can we say about this, this problem? Well, first of all, let's start with the even number parity ground state. That's completely Cooper paired, and by symmetry, the centre of mass should be at rest. If there were no trap there, it would just simply be the homogeneous BCS state, nothing at all unfamiliar. The trap will have an effect, but by symmetry, the effect has to be of order mu b over delta squared. Moreover, again from symmetry, the angular momentum has to be zero. So that means that, rather trivially, if we simply take the trap, which remember has nothing sitting in it, okay, we merely take the trap and move it once around the annulus, then the Berry phase is going to be zero. Nothing at all surprising about that. Now let's consider the odd parity ground state. Presumably the Cooper pairs are still at rest. There'll now be one quasar particle in your trap, and in the particle non-conserving approach, the usual Bogolyubov-Tjen approach, then the ground state is going to be given by this set of operators acting on the even parity ground state. So again, emphasize, it'll be a linear combination of an extra particle plus an extra hole. And crudely speaking, we expect the particle, the extra particle and the extra hole to be localized in this region here. Okay, so that's just iterating this. So relative to the even parity ground state, there's an equal admixture of extra particle and extra hole in the trap region. So in that region, there's no extra spin density. There is an extra spin density, but there's no extra particle density. That's a very, very standard conclusion in the literature. There's also no current associated with the quasar particle, therefore no angular momentum. So again, with the superfluid stationary, you just move the trap containing this extra quasar particle around the loop, bring it back to itself. Again, the Berry phase is zero. Now, here comes the interesting bit. Suppose the condensate is moving, and suppose we have essentially an Abrikosov vortex, or rather the core of an Abrikosov vortex, where at a distance our annulus has a radius which is large compared to the pair radius, but small compared to the London penetration depth, so we can neglect screening effects. Or we could be talking about helium 3A, say. So this is not the minimum velocity, it's the minimum circulation, h over 2m and not h over m. So again, we're going to move the trap once around the annulus adiabatically. The question is, what Berry phase is picked up? Well, first of all, what about the even parity ground state? Well, the even parity ground state, it has an angular momentum, which is an integral number, essentially angular momentum 1 for each Cooper pair, and you have an integral number of Cooper pairs, so phi is 2n pi, which is equivalent to 0. So if you just move the empty trap around, you should get nothing. Now here's the really nice question. What happens for the lowest odd parity state, where you've got this Bogolyubov quasar particle sitting in the trap? You're going to move it around once, and you ask, relative to the even parity ground state, what Berry phase do I pick up? That's in principle an experimentally meaningful question. I can think of ways of trying to answer that question. I have by now addressed this question to at least three international conferences consisting of people who believe would claim to be experts on Berry phases, Majorana fermions, dot, dot, dot. And the answers have been interesting. Possible answers are, the obvious answers are 0 or pi. Could be not, none of the above. It could be something, some nasty non-integral factor. Could be that the question is ill-defined, but I don't actually think that's right, because I think there are ways that you can answer this experimentally. So the answers I've got, I've occasionally had one of these two answers, but overwhelmingly I've had the answer either 0 or pi, with approximately a 50-50 split. Between the, most, I think, if anything, people have tended to go for pi, and you'll see why in a moment. But it seems to me rather interesting that you have this very basic question sitting there in the general theory of superfluidity, and no one is really quite sure about the answer. Okay, so let's just have a look at that very briefly, based on the Bogoliubov-Dirichlet equations. For the S-wave case and a spin-up quasar particle, your Bogoliubov-Dirichlet equations read the following way. V of r is some function of theta relative to the trap. Delta of r goes as e to the r phi. And for the moment, assume that the dependence on theta minus theta zero is real, although that's not entirely obvious. Then that dependence can't contribute to phi. So the problem, if this is right, then the problem is exactly analogous to the textbook spin-a-half problem, with alpha and beta replaced by u and v, as we said before. Moreover, for a bound state, we said that our bound state sits very close to the bottom of the continuum, that is, the energy is very close to delta. So that means, and as a matter of fact, this statement is more general, but what that actually means is that the magnitude of u is equal to the magnitude of v, that is, the amount of particle component is equal to the amount of whole component. And therefore, simply using the analogy with the spin-a-half particle, what you find is that the Berry phase is pi. And that's what follows then from the naive Bogoliubov-Dirichlet argument, assuming the usual concept of spontaneously broken U1 symmetry. And that's why I think probably the majority of the people who answered my quiz did opt for pi. That, incidentally, also follows, that would follow from the fact that that in a vortex with circulation 1, the difference between the angular momentum associated with the u and v components is 1. The angular momentum is a half. Remember that each of the u's occurs with probability a half, the v's occur with probability a half. So you get a half lu plus lv, that gives you n plus a half, where n is integral. That in turn gives you a Berry phase of pi, not 2 pi. Well, as I say, no one seems very sure about the answer to that question. But let's go back to the Ivanov problem. Again, just reviewing what we saw before, if we have paired vortices and we interchange them, then according to Ivanov, if there are no Majorana's, the Berry phase is 0. If there are two Majorana's, the phase is pi over 2. So that's equivalent to the statement that for the even number parity states, phi b is equal to 0 on encirclement. If we talk about encirclement rather than exchange, then for even number parity states, the phase is 0. For odd number parity states, pi. The question is, can we recover this prediction? Well, again, we can use the fundamental result that since psi is a function only of the difference theta minus the position of the vortex, then phi sub b is 2 pi times lz. Now, in the particle number conserving approach, non-conserving approach, which Ivanov takes, for the odd parity state, that means the angular momentum is a quarter. Now, we have to be careful here. The Dirac Bogoliubov fermion we're talking about is sitting half on one vortex and half on the other, and in each case it's half in the state u, the extra particle, half in the state v, the extra hole. So the expectation value of Lz is given by this expression here. However, since u star is equal to v, then Lu is minus Lv, so the expectation value of Lz is 0. Therefore, within the particle non-conserving approach, for the odd number parity state, the encirclement operation, we have phi b equals 0. That was not Ivanov's result. It's different. So we certainly do seem to have a problem here. Two, by using this general result relating the angular momentum to the Berry phase, and by assuming the usual particle non-conserving approach, that is the usual Bogoliubov-Tjian approach, we seem to have got a contradiction with Ivanov's result. And if that's right, that will totally screw up the possibility of using this stuff for topological quantum computing. So, what's gone wrong? Well, I'm going to indicate eventually at least a partial answer to this question. But I'm not going to do that in the next lecture, because in the next lecture, so I'll leave it with you to think about that. But I'll for the next lecture, I'm going to actually talk about something a bit more technical, which is the recent attempts over the last 3 or 4 years to try to actually produce and detect Majorana fermions, not in the original systems which were proposed, that is helium-3a and strontium-ruthenate, but rather in these engineered systems, semiconductor-superconductor hybrids. This has been a huge sort of bandwagon over the last 3 or 4 years. I certainly won't be able to review anything like the whole of this literature. I'm not going to attempt to do so, but I'll try to at least indicate the basic ideas which have been used and the basic results which people have attained in this area.
So they're going to use these spin orbital coupling again?
Sorry, yeah. Yes. Yes, it turns out, yes. Yes, it's a very interesting idea. Crudely speaking, and we'll get into this in detail in the next lecture, the idea is that by taking an ordinary superconductor and putting it next to a wire, first of all, you can, as it were, inject Cooper pairs into a normal system which sits next to the superconductor. That's a fairly well-known effect. It's been known for many years. What's interesting is that you can take an ordinary superconductor and at first sight inject just ordinary Cooper pairs, but then if you have if in your normal system you have a strong spin orbit coupling, what that means is that in effect you create P wave and not S wave Cooper pairs in that system. That actually, in some sense, that's an effect which has been known in a different context for many, many years. Ever since the early 60s, in fact, there's been a nice theory of superconductivity, bulk superconductivity in systems containing spin orbit scatterers. And what happens there, crudely speaking, is that the interaction is very short range. The interaction in a typical bulk superconductor of the traditional kind is very short range. So basically, at short range, you form your Cooper pairs in a spin singlet state. You can almost regard the potential as a delta function, and to get close enough together to sample it, the pairs have to be in a spin singlet state. Otherwise, the Pauli principle forbids it. But now, as the particles start wandering off, they will be subject to spin orbit scattering, so that sometimes the spin of one of those two electrons in the Cooper pair will be flipped. So now, relative to its partner, it's going to be in a spin triplet state, not a spin singlet. So that effect has been known for many years, and is important when one comes to consider the experimental data on superconductors with heavy metal superconductors that have a lot of spin orbit scattering. What's very interesting is that by using this idea, one can produce the necessary conditions to generate Majorana fermion type solutions, and that's basically what the recent fuss has been about. Okay, I think I'd better stop at this point and see you then on next Tuesday. Yeah.